Thank you for joining us for today's Dean Seminar Series on Chronic Disease. Here is Dr. Jeremiah Barondess.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us for today's seminar. I want to introduce this with a little anecdote. Several decades ago, a friend of mine was finishing his residency training in internal medicine at a major academic research intensive center. And he was talking to his department chair about his plans. He said he thought he'd like to go into infectious disease as a subspecialty. "Don't be foolish," said his department chair. "Infectious diseases are dead. Antibiotics are going to fix all that. Do something else." He did something else. And brilliantly, I might say, but contrary to the chairman's opinion, infectious diseases obviously have persisted at endemic, epidemic, and periodically pandemic levels, continue to present challenges, not just from agents we're familiar with, but new ones as organisms mutate or exchange genetic material, or as human and animal ecosystems interface. So the challenges continue to arise and to evolve. Many of the new agents involved are viruses. For almost all of them, there are no effective therapeutic interventions. And in any event, public health interventions are required for their control, including especially vaccines. The safety and effectiveness of the vaccines in common use have been demonstrated many times over, from striking impacts on the formerly nearly universal childhood exanthems, measles, mumps, et cetera, but also extending to the eradication of smallpox, the near eradication of poliomyelitis, prevention of human papillomavirus infection, and a number of derivative cancers. These vaccines, it's worth noticing, have been introduced only after rigorous evaluations and trials have found them to be safe, remarkably safe, in fact. So we believe there's a reasonable basis for recommending them for widespread use. And by and large, acceptance of new vaccines has ultimately been widespread, even though it has sometimes been hesitant. Public confidence has periodically, I should add, been severely shaken by rare but frightening adverse events, including, for example, an outbreak of poliomyelitis in the 1950s related to two lots of vaccine in which live virus had persisted. Later, a large outbreak of Guillain-Barré neuropathy following a massive smallpox vaccination program here in the 1980s. Later, problems with small bowel obstruction in infants after rotavirus immunizations. And now major problems and interruptions of major immunization programs following episodes of thrombosis and thrombocytopenia associated with the AstraZeneca vaccine for COVID-19, and newly, apparently, a few cases associated with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. Public acceptance, of course, is critical to the deployment and the ongoing use of these vaccines. By and large, it's been good. Vaccine hesitancy, as it's called, is sometimes based on inadequate information or misinformation, and sometimes it's based on distrust of science, of scientists, of government, of the pharmaceutical industry, what have you. And it's worth noticing hesitancy varies over time. It varies by age, gender, race, ethnicity, even political affiliation. And some of those attitudes can be very firmly held, witness the persisting association in some people's minds of autism risk with the standard childhood immunizations. So safety concerns are critical. How do we know vaccine safety when we meet it? How much risk is acceptable and to whom? A number of other knotty questions persist, and we're very fortunate to have with us today two people who are superbly informed and leaders in these issues. Dr. David Knipe, our visiting seminarist, is the Higgins Professor of Microbiology and Molecular Genetics at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Knipe holds his doctorate in cell biology from MIT, had a postdoctoral fellowship at the University of Chicago, focused on the molecular genetics of herpes simplex virus, and he has pursued the dynamics of herpes virus biology and infection over the more than four decades since then. His chief research interests include epigenetic mechanisms in host and virus gene expression, recombinant herpes simplex strains as vaccine candidates, and mechanisms in latent infection. His bibliography also includes thoughtful consideration of the intricacies of establishing and tracking vaccine safety. He's a widely sought consultant, an honorary lecturer, a prolific contributor to the literature in his field, and as I said, we're lucky to have him with us. Our faculty commentator is a clinician. Dr. Danielle Laraque-Arena is an adjunct professor of epidemiology here at the Mailman School and senior scholar in residence at the New York Academy of Medicine. She holds her MD from UCLA and trained in pediatrics at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. She's a former president of the SUNY Upstate Medical Center at Syracuse and of the Academic Pediatric Association. Her particular interests have been in child abuse, childhood injury, the quality of pediatric care, and childhood immunizations. We will start with Dr. Knipe, segue seamlessly to Dr. Laraque-Arena, and then we will have an opportunity for questions from the viewers. So David, all yours.
Thank you. Let me share my screen. So thank you, Dr. Barondess, for the kind introduction and for the invitation to speak at this exciting series of seminars. Dr. Barondess had asked me to talk about our science article that we had, in which we discussed the ways to ensure safety for the COVID vaccines. And as I started to think about how I could talk about that for 40 minutes, I thought that there has been so much written that you probably knew more about it than I did. But as the news continues, and every day there's something new to talk about, but I thought that the best way to sort of really show the situation with the COVID vaccines and the safety issues was to contrast it with another vaccine, the herpes vaccines, which are really quite different and really illustrate the issues around vaccine safety and development. And so I'm going to do that today. And so I just have to say that I have one conflict, and that's that I'm a co-inventor on a patent that's licensed to Sanofi Pasteur for our genital herpes vaccine technology, and I'll be alluding to that today as well. So as I said, we published an article in November, December of last year, a commentary in Science on ensuring vaccine safety. And late last summer, early fall, we were concerned, like I think many of you were, about whether the previous administration was going to rush the COVID vaccines into use before the election for political reasons. And so we wanted to write, Ofer Levy from Boston Children's Hospital, Kate Fitzgerald from the University of Massachusetts School of Medicine, and Elke Muhlberger from BU Medical School. We wanted to write an article, a commentary, in which we said, had a couple of main issues, and that was that the COVID vaccines would be safe if the protocols for developing them and for their safety review followed all of the existing protocols of the FDA and the other regulatory agencies, and that there were no shortcuts taken. And we also wanted to provide the sort of the historical scientific basis for those protocols and for safety evaluation of vaccines, and to discuss what science has told us about from previous vaccines, and to discuss that. And so there were sort of four major principles that we wanted to put forth, and that is that we had learned that, first of all, that we need to pay careful attention to the design of safe vaccines. They have to be designed to be safe. And then we need to do systematic testing of the vaccine product from the preclinical through the post-licensure periods. And Dr. Barondess has already alluded to what's been called the Cutter Lab incident, where there were two batches of polio vaccine that were not inactivated completely, and it led to some disease being induced by the vaccine themselves. And so this has led to a careful set of protocols for systematic evaluation of vaccines. And secondly, we've learned that we need to understand the correlates of immunity in order to optimize the vaccine efficacy. And we have to know what we're trying to induce in order to have the best vaccine. And a couple of examples where we've learned from were the respiratory syncytial vaccine that was inactivated, and that induced an unbalanced response between the two glycoproteins that wasn't completely neutralizing, and also it was biased towards a Th2 response. And vaccinated kids that were then that then got infected showed enhanced disease. And also for the dengue vaccines, the first dengue vaccine, there wasn't a balanced immune response for all of the serotypes, the four serotypes, and so there was enhanced disease that was observed there. So we need to understand correlates of immunity and try to achieve the best immune responses possible. Thirdly, additional vaccine testing, clinical testing is warranted if we observe serious adverse events. And this was historically the 1976 polio vaccine, and which was rushed through so that before President Ford's reelection campaign. And even though there was a low level of Guillain-Barré syndrome paralysis that was observed, it was determined that it wasn't enough to warrant going forward. And then the clinical trials then showed larger amounts of disease. And so there was, we need to pause clinical testing if we see any adverse effects. And we'll, obviously that's very timely today, and we'll come back to that. And then finally, I guess my numbering is problematic here, but if we need to have continued surveillance, and this is where we are, through all the steps through development and from preclinical to licensure and afterwards, and in order to find out if there's really anything, make sure that things are completely safe. And again, the rotavirus, one of the first rotavirus vaccine showed a small amount of intussusception or small bowel telescoping and obstruction. But then after licensure, there was more disease observed, and actually this vaccine was taken off the market. because of that. So as I said, I'm going to talk about two vaccines that illustrate sort of the issues with regard to urgency versus prudence. And the COVID vaccine really is sort of on the edge, on the balance, on the side of the balance for urgency, whereas the herpes vaccine is more on the side of prudence. So obviously, you know all of this about the COVID. There were large numbers of deaths, and there was an emergency medical need, and the pandemic led to a strong justification to obtain and test multiple vaccines. And so again, we know that the pandemic was declared in March of last year, and cases rose rapidly in the United States and around the world. And really there was a very urgent need for a vaccine to protect against COVID, but we obviously needed to be safe. And there were three major types of vaccines that the US prioritized for development. First, a protein-based vaccine. This was one that was developed by, this is still being developed and being tested by Novavax, which you just look at directly inject a protein. The second is a new technology, the mRNA vaccines, where mRNA encoding the COVID spike protein is encased in a lipid nanoparticle, and then it's injected, and the mRNA directly makes the spike protein, which induces an immune response. So this would be, for the virologist, it's just like a positive strand RNA virus, where the RNA in the particle directly encodes the protein. The third one was an adenovirus vector vaccine for Johnson & Johnson. It's adeno 26 type serotype. And for the AstraZeneca, it's a chimpanzee adenovirus. And so the gene is inserted into the genome, and then that's expressed after injection to induce the immune response. So so two of these, the RNA and the J&J vaccine, have been approved for, have granted emergency use authorization in the United States, and the AstraZeneca in Europe and elsewhere. And so this led to the big campaigns and the big vaccination campaigns. I got mine at Fenway Park in Boston, which is now reverted. It's a sort of historical now because it's been reverted for baseball use, but lots of us have been vaccinated. But what about our safety issues? Have those been fulfilled? And this is obviously a moving target with this morning's announcement that the J&J vaccine has been paused in the United States. So first of all, what about design of safe vaccine and systematic testing? And fortunately, the COVID vaccines were relatively safe in the trials, and they were very efficacious. So it was very easy to justify their use on the emergency use on the basis of the efficacy versus risk balance. But we have had some situations where the preparation of the vaccine has been compromised, and you're all aware of the emergent biosolutions contamination of the J&J vaccine with the AstraZeneca vaccine, where they're making them both in the same plant. I haven't figured out exactly what happened here, but it's clear that we still have to, but you can never be too cautious when you're producing vaccines. So it's an ongoing concern, but so far there were no injuries to anyone. There was no harm done to anyone, but it did set back the implementation of the J&J vaccine. So more people could be infected and there could be disease and even deaths as a result of the delay, but that's indirectly affected. Number two, to understand the correlates of immunity. We know that neutralizing antibody correlates with the protection against COVID-2 in non-human primates. We don't know that that's a true immune correlate versus just an indirect surrogate marker kind of thing, but we do have a benchmark in which to monitor future vaccines. And we're gathering data, and the clinical trials data is still, I mean, the clinical trial data and the utilization data are accumulating. And so we will eventually have some more information about this. So number three, the timely one, additional clinical testing is warranted if we see adverse effects. And in the past, the trials were paused. And the important thing here is that they're paused, that they're not stopped permanently when adverse events were observed. We had transverse myelitis with the AstraZeneca vaccine. And this just means the system is working. And now with the clotting problems observed with the J&J vaccine and AstraZeneca in Europe, the trials are paused in the United States. So this means the system is working. And so we'll try to figure out what the population is that's at risk for this. And hopefully these can be resumed very quickly and we can figure this out. And so this is something I'm sure that people will want to discuss later. But this leads to the continued surveillance which is really needed at all steps, including post-licensure. And so this has to be, we have to continually be vigilant. And so this is not just, the analyzing the clinical, just the trials and looking for severe adverse effects. But I think that, and this is something that maybe hopefully some of you will be interested in, and that's to try to use bioinformatic analysis, the sort of big data sets to detect low level events and trends that would only be seen once you have significant power to look at that. But certainly the fragmented US healthcare system will hinder this, and perhaps the UK National Health Service will be better. But anyway, so this is how I view it, our safety points, and I think there'll be plenty here to discuss later. So then turning to the contrasting situation with the herpes vaccines, and there is a medical need, thousands of deaths from encephalitis, neonatal herpes, and then there's lots of morbidity due to keratitis and genital herpes. But most of the infections are not life-threatening, and so the vaccine needs to be very safe. And so there's a complex set of immune correlates that we know about so far, and there's really been a perceived business risk for the vaccine development. So in terms of, just to talk a little bit more about the medical implications for HSV-1, which commonly causes cold sores, fever blisters, in the US population, there's high seroprevalence, but the virus can also infect the cornea and cause a recurrent herpes keratitis, which is a leading cause of blindness. The virus can spread to the central nervous system, although rarely, but there's still over 1,000 cases estimated in the United States per year. And then there's also been a long-term association with neurological disease and even speculations about its role in Alzheimer's. For HSV-2, historically the major cause of genital herpes, but there is HSV-1 now increasing for genital herpes in the US. And it's only 17% or less than 20% seropositivity in the US, but much larger levels in the developing countries. There's still 500,000 cases of genital herpes per year, and babies can be born can be infected during delivery, and that's half of those cases are life-threatening. And so there's a significant major number of cases worldwide for that. It's disseminated in AIDS and immunocompromised patients, and the epidemiologists have told us that it promotes HIV transmission and acquisition. But genital herpes, or HSV-2, shows a higher disease burden in Black populations. From the latest data from the CDC, in Black populations, the seroprevalence is three to four times that of other populations. So this is the latest data from the CDC. This is a table. I should have also said that I have a disclosure that I'm co-editor of Fields Virology. a book that's in one, a recent, a volume that's in press. But for, so there's a high, it's highly prevalent in Black populations, and it's even higher, in females, as for all the populations, but it's very high in Black women. So there is a, there are disparities here in terms of the disease burden among the different populations. And so this is, there's an urgent need for a vaccine. But as I said, there's a co-epidemic of HIV and genital herpes, HSV2, around the world, with large numbers of cases of HIV and HSV2 in sub-Saharan Africa and in Asia. And as I alluded to, there are epidemiological studies linking HSV2 as a risk factor for HIV. And Esther Friedman's work has shown with longitudinal studies that HSV2 is associated with an increased risk of HIV infection in both men and women. And that's for both acquisition and transmission. So a genital herpes vaccine, a herpes vaccine could also reduce the levels of HIV infection around the world. Now, you know that HSV biology consists of the virus infecting epithelial cells and fibroblasts at a mucosal surface. In the case of oral infection, it causes the primary herpes stomatitis, and these are lytic productive infection of these cells. It expresses some 80 protein products, and the immune system will clear this, but not before the virus can enter, can bind to the axon of a sensory neuron. Nucleocapsid is transported up the axon, and then the DNA is released into the nucleus, where it establishes a latent non-permissive infection. And there the virus expresses only some non-coding RNAs. The latency-associated transcript is shown here with this fluorescent in situ hybridization, or FISH. And the virus can stay there for our lifetime. But if the neuron, if sensory neuron is injured, or hormonal stress can lead to reactivation, some production of virus to cause the recurrent infection at the mucosal site. So in terms of vaccines, a prophylactic vaccine could prevent the primary infection or could reduce the primary infection, whereas a therapeutic vaccine could reduce reactivation. And so there's the potential for a couple different kinds of vaccines. Now, the lytic infection by the virus involves entry through either fusion or endocytosis, and then the DNA is released into the nucleus, and then there's immediate early gene products are expressed that turn on earlies. The early proteins are involved in DNA replication, and then the late genes are made, which assemble the viral particles to produce the progeny particles. So there's a whole series, there's a cascade of genes that are expressed. So as I said, there are demonstrated medical needs for herpes vaccine, and the herpes vaccines can be prophylactic. And an example of that is the Varivax or the varicella vaccine that prevents chickenpox. Or they could be therapeutic and reduce recurrent infections. And there's Zostavax, and then Shingrix, which is the one that's currently being used. Zostavax was a live attenuated virus, and Shingrix is a glycoprotein subunit vaccine, two formulations there. As I said, the correlates of immunity are complex, and in that antibodies will protect against CNS infection. CD4 and CD8 T cells will provide local infection against primary infection, and CD8 T cells are thought to protect against reactivation. So that's a big task to try to generate enough immune responses to be fully protective. And perhaps as a result of that, the classical vaccine approaches have not worked with the herpes vaccines thus far. Nothing has been approved. And the live attenuated virus showed limited immunogenicity, and probably by the time you get it so it's safe, it's not very immunogenic. And then two glycoprotein vaccines, first from the Chiron, a previous company, was not efficacious in prophylactic or therapeutic trials. The GSK glycoprotein vaccine was not effective overall, but even though the trial really didn't have an arm to show this, if they broke it down, it appeared to be a significant reduction in HSV seronegative women. But they did a repeat study with seronegative women alone, and there was no efficacy against HSV2 and limited efficacy against HSV1 genital herpes. Although this was like a 33% reduction, which some of the AIDS vaccine people have said they would consider that a success. But I think GSK stopped that work. And this led to an article in Science by John Cohen. And I think that this article from 2010 really emphasized the risk that was perceived by companies and everyone that herpes vaccine was very difficult to achieve. And I think even then I was quoted as saying that, you know, we needed more support from the government to really develop this difficult vaccine. Other vaccine candidates have been tested. Another live attenuated vaccine, DNA, a single cycle mutant virus, peptides, and even the Biovex attenuated virus, which this eventually became T-VEC, the oncolytic vaccine, and not used as a vaccine virus, but not oncolytic virus and not used as a vaccine virus. So my lab was designing and testing replication defective viruses as vaccines. Those are viruses that are genetically engineered to replicate only in cells that express a complementing gene product and not in normal cells. So if we go back to that replication cycle, the first ones that we tested were defective for DNA synthesis. And so they would make immediate early-earlies and even some of the late proteins. But in normal cells, you only get part of the replication cycle, but you need to grow them on a complementing cell line. So this is really what the adenovectors vaccines are. They are replication defective viruses that grow on a complementing cell line and then are used to just infect one round of cells. As I said, they're grown on a complementing cell in culture to get the product infectious virus, but in a normal cell, you don't get any virus produced. So they have the benefits of a live viral vaccine to an extent, but the safety of a subunit vaccine, perhaps. So 1992, we first showed that replication defective viruses would induce survival against a herpes virus challenge. And then we went on to develop an HSV2 vaccine with called DL529. And that virus we've tested in animals. It was licensed first to Acambus and then they were bought by Sanofi Pasteur for development of a vaccine. And so HSV, the DL529 contains two deletions in essential proteins UL5 and UL29 that are required for DNA replication. We introduced two deletions for safety reasons, and it grows on a complementing cell line to produce in culture. And then if you just look at the proteins that are expressed by this, by the virus, the DL529 versus the wild type, they both express a large number of viral proteins relative to the mock infected cells. And DL529 is missing UL29 here. And you can't really see UL5 on this gel, but they produce a wide variety of proteins and they induce a strong Th1 response. And so we think it's a very broad protection that could be induced. And if we look in guinea pigs, this was with Steve Strauss's lab at NIH, that the DL529 reduces viral shedding. It almost eliminates genital lesions or disease. And if you look at recurrences that come back from that, there's very little. And if you measure viral DNA in the immunized animals, there's almost no latent viral DNA compared to the control animals. So it can protect against primary infection, disease, and latent infection. and shows some effect as a therapeutic vaccine. If you infect first and then give the vaccine, that it will reduce the number of lesions. Clearly, therapeutic vaccines are more difficult, I think, than the prophylactic, but it's the possibility of both. But there have been many questions about the feasibility of a herpes vaccine. How can you do better than natural immunity, which can't control recurrent infections? And so we thought that perhaps part of that would be that by giving the vaccine by alternative routes, other than the mucosal exposure that the virus normally infects, that we could improve efficacy. And indeed, when we used intramuscular inoculation of the vaccine, we saw protection against disease. It was better than subcutaneous in the control, and there was better reduction of virus shedding. So by 6 days, the virus is gone, and there's largely, you can do much better in terms of protecting the animals from paralysis if you go intramuscular. This is in mice. And we also established a non-lethal model in which we infected with a genital infection of mice with a TK minus virus, and we saw disease that was then cleared. If we immunized intramuscularly, we could prevent all disease. We could reduce virus shedding. We wouldn't prevent it all, but it wasn't sterilizing immunity, but it would reduce shedding, but it did protect against latent infection. So we can get sterilizing immunity. We don't get sterilizing immunity in terms of preventing all infection, but we prevent disease, we prevent latent infection, and we can also prevent seroconversion with looking at the induction of antiviral antibodies upon infection, and with the intramuscular immunization, we can prevent all of that. So it is possible to prevent latent infection and to prevent seroconversion by immunization, even if you don't have sterilizing immunity. So there are ways to get this to be better than natural immunity. And a clinical trial, a phase one clinical trial was done with the Sanofi Pasteur version of DL529 that they call their clinical product called HSV529. And the vaccine was done by Jeff Cohen with the Sanofi Pasteur people. It was safe and well tolerated. The vaccine induced antibody and CD4 responses in seronegative individuals, but there was limited boosting of immunity in seronegative and seropositive individuals. So there's room for improvement. So it looked like it could be a prophylactic vaccine. Ironically, Sanofi Pasteur is further testing it as a therapeutic vaccine, but that's the focus of, I think, all the companies right now, is a therapeutic vaccine. So we need support from government or other agencies to support a prophylactic vaccine, which is sort of what the world needs. So we and others are working on next generation herpes vaccines. Viruses express more gene products in human cells. Viruses that are defective for a viral protein, ICP47, that prevents MHC class one presentation and generation of CD8 T cells, and then viruses that can be more easily produced to give larger doses for immunization. And in 2012, after the GSK vaccine failure, we had a workshop at NIH that Larry Corey and I organized with Jeff Cohen and Carolyn Deal. And there was uniform support for NIH mounting programs and there was also support. There were reports from the World Health Organization that herpes vaccines are a priority. Yet none of these programs have developed. I mean, there have been other pressing needs that have come up, but there's still no priority for herpes vaccines. Now, what's going to raise the issues? What's going to raise the need for a herpes vaccine, and how else can it be employed? And I just want to spend just a little bit of time here and finishing up on a recent, some recent work that was done with David, excuse me, with David Lieb's lab at Dartmouth. And David Lieb was really the, who did all the biology here and in using our vaccines. And what they did was to use maternal immunization to confer protection against neonatal herpes simplex virus infection. But they also set up a mouse model for herpes infection inducing behavioral changes and probably neurological changes, and then showed that maternal immunization could protect against it. So I think this is a big thing for the future. And so what they did was to immunize female mice, two doses, and then bred them, and then took the pups and either infected them or measured the serum antibodies. Either in the mothers, they found GD and glycoprotein D, glycoprotein B antibodies. They found the same thing in the baby mice, GD and GB antibodies. And so when they challenged, they immunized the mothers, they bred them, and then they took the pups and they infected them intranasally with, in this case, about 10 to the fifth PFUs of HSV1 virus intranasally, as I said. And then they looked at viral titers, and the immunized mice are here in red. And you can see that the viral titers are much lower in all the tissues. They didn't completely prevent infection of in the lungs, but there was a significant reduction. They protected against, and they led to survival with HSV1 challenge, and largely survival in the HSV2 challenge. So they wanted to know whether this was due to placental or milk transfer of antibodies. And so they did a fostering experiment where they had the birth mothers were either, and the foster mothers were either immunized or not immunized. And so obviously if with both are immunized, they got protection. If both were unimmunized, then they had a lethal infection from this. But if the foster mother was immunized, they got protection. So that meant that milk could transfer antibodies. Or if the birth mother was immunized, then they could get indicating that there was placental transfer of antibodies. So you can get protection by maternal antibodies in this mouse model. But they also set up, as I said, they set up they did some behavioral tests, and they used an open field test as a measure of behavior, as a measure of anxiety in the infected mice. So what they did was to immunize the mothers. Well, these were actually late. These mothers were immunized, were either infected or lately infected or uninfected, and then they were challenged again at day one or day two with HSV1. And what they saw in the open field test was in the mock infected animals that the mice spent a large amount of their time at the periphery. And this was what they call, so there was high levels of anxiety. They weren't exploring the internal parts of the field, as opposed to the latently infected cells, the infected animals, mothers, the progeny virus. So these were tests. The behavioral tests were done 5 weeks after infection. Sorry, they were young adult mice. So then the latently infected animals seemed to be protected and showed normal behavior. So in contrast, so the if you measure thigmotaxis or the anxiety or staying around the outside, it was high for the mock infected, but around the 50% level of the mock infect of control animals with if they were latently infected. And so they saw the same thing with the immunized animals versus the mock immunized mothers, that the progeny mice, when infected and then allowed to go become adults, if they were immunized, they showed, they were explored, and they showed a normal level of stigmotaxis, similar to the control animals, but if they weren't immunized, then they showed a high level of anxiety and stayed around the outside of the open field of the field test. So this replication defective virus will work in mouse and guinea pig models. It induced antibodies and CD4 responses in seronegative individuals in a phase one trial. It was safe. And we and others are working on improved next generation vaccines. I think importantly, in terms of HSV's connection to neurological diseases, we have an animal model that may be used for behavioral and neurological changes, and you can protect by maternal immunization. So the two vaccines really show the two extremes. The pandemic led to an urgent need for rapid implementation of COVID vaccines, and the high efficacy and low adverse effects really gave us a clear answer to go ahead with utilization. But there's also a need for HSV and for other vaccines. There's a perceived business risk and a very complex problem. And safety remains an important feature of an HSV vaccine. And Zostavax, as a live attenuated virus, was actually taken off the market by Merck last year because of problems with potential latent infections or zoster from the vaccine. So in terms of lessons for the future, so certainly the urgent situation with COVID showed what can be accomplished when there's a strong commitment by the government and everyone pitches in together and really focus on developing a vaccine. And the flip side of this is that there are many other vaccines that don't have a strong commitment, and there's a strong medical need, and we need to develop vaccines for all of these diseases and prevent them. And there is a role for government support for financially risky vaccines and vaccines that address health disparities. And I showed you the John Cohen article from 2010 in Science, where many of us were saying this a while ago. So just to close then, in terms of preparedness for future pandemics, now I'm just going to get up on my soapbox, but preparedness requires obviously surveillance, diagnostics, therapeutics, and vaccines, and be ready with platforms for all of those. But we also need to do broad-based basic science on all of the microbes and host immune responses, because we do not know where the next infectious disease outbreak will be caused by. And so we need to study all of the microbes and not be caught knowing very little about coronaviruses as we have sometime. But we've done very well in responding, but we do need to do everything. So with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Laraque-Arena to continue on with the discussion. And I will stop sharing. Danielle.
Great, good morning. And I'll wait for my slides to come up. So I wanna thank Dr. Jeremiah Barondess and Dr. Knipe for setting the stage for the next part of our discussion. And next slide, please. And I have one disclosure, and it is that I'm a member of the board of directors of Vaccinate Your Family, which is the next generation of what you may know as Every Child by Two. And I raise this because I will also be focusing a lot of a systems response to public acceptance of vaccines and the deployment of vaccines. And this organization, a not-for-profit, has been involved in those issues. Next slide, please. So I want to thank Dr. Knipe. He set the scientific basis of vaccines. And as a pediatrician, I can say to you that, of course, the big challenges of the 20th century and the shift to what we now call new morbidities was that we were able to respond to infectious disease threats. And as Dr. Barondess warned us, is that we prematurely perhaps declared winning the war against infectious diseases. And I've lived through the HIV/AIDS pandemic, where we were reminded of the need for focus on infectious diseases and public health, public health response. And again, many of us did not think we would live through a pandemic, but we have been in this situation for the last year. Dr. Knipe's presentation signaled a few things other than knowing the science, which now I think many of us, the terms mRNA are on, I don't think we had envisioned that we would be discussing at the dinner table mRNA and adenovirus vectors, but we are here, and I believe it's a good thing that we have further exposure to the scientific basis for vaccines, and we'll talk about that with respect to vaccine hesitancy. He signaled the importance of ensuring safety at every stage of the process, and we're reminded of that with the current Johnson & Johnson pause of the vaccine to take a look at the implications of the adverse effects that we are seeing and whether they merit a complete cessation of that rollout or not. And then contrasted urgency versus prudence. And I'm going to begin there with respect to urgency and the historical context, which he reviewed a bit in terms of historical context, but I'm going to broaden that discussion even more. And then, of course, what we want to do is to understand from this pandemic, one, is lessons learned in the process and how we apply it to the equitable deployment, not only development of vaccines, but the equitable deployment of vaccines to attain the outcomes that we want, which is the reduction of death and severe morbidity and perhaps elimination of that. So feasible strategies. Next slide, please. So I begin, for some of you, this may not be new, but I want to set the context for our discussion. The context for our discussion is certainly unequal treatment, IOM report, and I'm going to quote directly from the findings. A small number of studies suggest that racial and ethnic minority patients are more likely than white patients to refuse treatment. These findings find that differences in refusal rates are generally small and that minority patients' refusal does not fully explain healthcare disparities. And we're going to delve into that a little bit in terms of how our data can help us in understanding the epidemiology and how our systems can be structured to be able to respond effectively and equitably. And one recommendation from the IOM report that stuck out as I reviewed this for this is, quote, avoid fragmentation of health plans along socioeconomic lines. And Dr. Knipe, you already stated to us, quote, a fragmented US healthcare system. And I think this is contributing to our difficulties in responding to this pandemic and also the disparities in disease burden. Next slide, please. I'm going to go pretty quickly on this. Some of you may have seen that the Lancet Commission on Vaccine Refusal Acceptance and Demand stating the following, that the vaccine refusal has accelerated. So we need to understand this. And this predated certainly COVID. Increased non-medical exemptions, you'll see in school immunization requirements linked to outbreaks, and organized anti-vaccine activities, which go beyond the health disparities and some of the historical racial, ethnic, and economic disparities that we're talking about, which has been linked to distrust from historical exploitation and current mistreatment, which I don't have the time to review, but everyone now is aware of the Tuskegee trial. And the distrust that that bred in the lack of transparency and the lack of acting in good faith vis-a-vis communities. So this commission, which was just launched in 2020 and will report out in 2022, will actually try to collate data on trends of vaccine hesitancy. And I can say right now that in fact, the data are quite limited in terms of racial disparities with respect to vaccines. So I'm gonna ask you to hold off on conclusions and to rely on the data and the epidemiology and to be able to to look at the public health implications of future trends and the role of various actors in this endeavor, and to mitigate against certainly anti-vaccine activities, but also in the positive, to actually put into place systems that actually promote fair distribution. Next slide, please. This is not a surprise, but I did think it was relevant to look at the leading causes of death, that COVID now ranks third in the US for leading causes of death in a short period of a year. And that's pretty astounding. So the urgency that we talked about is certainly there. Next slide. So what's the perception? According to recent polls, and I quote Health Leads, which is an innovation hub addressing racial inequity. So I chose it specifically, but these are similar data in different venues. Only 58% of the US population would get vaccinated as soon as COVID vaccines became available, and that the vaccine distribution strategies proposed in the US lack clear focus on racial health equity and clear coordination. And I want to focus on the coordination of the federal, state, tribal, and other levels. And for another study pointed out that there are about 37 billion individuals who would accept vaccination, with an overall, from the literature review, of 68.4% of global population willing to receive the vaccine. So I'm going to focus your attention on the positive, what it is that we can do. Next slide. Very quickly, overview of staff flu vaccination you see here reduces the risk of hospitalization for babies 6 months and older by about 72%. The Tdap vaccination is now routine for all pregnancies, and you see the data there in terms of protecting infants. And David pointed out some of the approaches to maternal vaccination to protect infants and the mother. And that, however, that only one in three pregnant women get both flu and Tdap vaccine, despite knowing its efficacy. And I want to point out an important point with respect to credible messengers. The following statement, which you see there: pregnant women whose healthcare providers offered and referred them for vaccination had the highest vaccination rates. So on the positive end, we've known the influence of healthcare professionals in affecting behavior. And while in this talk, I don't have the time to discuss that behavior, I do want to point out that I would not begin with the deficit model of what we're lacking, but what it is we can positively do. Next slide. This is vaccine hesitancy. We have maternal vaccination, which has been accepted. If you look at MMR, varicella, median vaccination coverage for infants, okay, by age two, exceeds 90%. So we have successes. We know there have been some hesitancies with respect to HPV. We surveyed national representative study of networks of pediatricians and family physicians from 2008 to 2018 in one study, and they concluded the following: that more primary care physicians reported recommending HPV vaccination for adolescents, fewer reported barriers. Unfortunately, more physicians reported parents who had vaccine safety or moral and religious concerns. So that's a red flag to us that we need to attend to these if we're going to have a public health approach to this. Next slide. I'm going quickly because, in fact, we have limited time to discuss. This is our successes in flu vaccine vaccination. You see at the youngest ages, we have the most success. Maybe that tugs at our hearts to prevent disease in young children. And then that drops off for the 13 to 17 year old. And the adult vaccination rate coverage for adults for flu is about 48%. So there is a fall off. Next slide. So the next two slides, I want to focus on what it is we can do in terms of a framework for action. Certainly from the Department of Epidemiology, it's not surprising that I would think that in understanding, accepting sort of the activities that are focused on addressing vaccines and COVID, that epidemiology plays a critical role. And what I would urge here is CDC data stratified based on age, race, gender, and race is a social construct, but it's important in stratifying data. Pregnancy status, which in this first report by the CDC on pregnancy and COVID, 64.5% of pregnancy status, the pregnancy status of reproductive age women was missing. So missing data is critical to address, because then you can, looking at geographic surveillance, contact, and vaccine distribution data, you don't have the data that you need to be able to have to mount an important surveillance program as well as distribution assessment. The research we talked about, so I'm not going to belabor this, although I will point to the fact that randomized controlled trials can be designed with an equity lens by being very transparent about who is being enrolled in those vaccine trials, which will, I believe, support vaccine acceptance by the public. Ethical considerations, again, we don't have time to discuss, but access, access, access. So the confounder of whether or not people are hesitating because they don't have sufficient information about access becomes critical. And I would urge a special populations consideration with pregnant women and children. And then clarity and credibility of our public health messages. And there are many, many different tools that are being used, such as public deliberation, to begin to do that. The next slide focuses on the deployment strategies. And I want to focus on the deployment framework. The CDC needs to provide data stratified, as I said, for this in order to, one, understand the areas of focus, but also to understand where the equitable distribution of vaccine lies. So you see deployment framework on the left, public health principles of herd immunity, no missed opportunities. This is something in pediatrics we learned, that we used to insist that patients come in and that they keep their appointments. And we said, no, whenever there's a touch point with a patient, then we don't miss the opportunities. There is no wrong door for vaccination. Local deployment, medical home eliminated the disparity in immunizations for those age two. We should look at those models that provide equitable health care in a non-fragmented way that supports vaccine equity. Urgency of deployment, we talked on, and prioritization, which we saw in prioritizing chronically ill individuals first, and effectiveness. Now, I want to spend a couple of a minute or so, and Dr. Barondess, I know you're following us quickly to see the timing, but give me a couple of minutes, that the WHO, of course, has been prominent in its role in terms of the COVID at a global level. The recent COVAX is a framework where 190 countries have participated. But note, the US is not a participant, and perhaps the Biden administration will weigh in on this, is that there's a formation of COVAX, which is a COVID vaccine global access facility, which is co-led by Gavi, the Global Immunization Vaccine Immunization Coalition, the Coalition of Epidemic Preparedness, Innovation, and WHO, to provide a framework. That framework is initially a proportional allocation that all countries get initially 3% based on their population, and then 20% of vaccine distribution. And then beyond 20% of vaccine distribution, then it's based on need. Now, there's been recent commentaries regarding an additional emphasis on special situations and needs, where we're contrasting countries that have the same populations but have different prevalence and incidence of disease, and therefore their need exceeds. There are frameworks, and what I think in the first discussion we said that the US is lacking a framework for this is that the US needs to adopt a similar framework for equitable distribution that looks at the equity, the ethics of distribution of vaccines and consideration for special populations. Okay, now I've gone through this pretty quickly, but next slide. Next slide. We know that this cross-functional approach to solving health problems, we've seen an acceleration of vaccine development with COVID. We have known of this problem of the valley of death, which is called in the translational pathway. And again, I hope that the lessons learned is not to repeat the mistakes of the past, but to apply the lessons of acceleration of vaccine development with clarity and not missing steps on safety will be important. Next slide. Yes, RCTs can be devised with a lens on equity, and I refer you to Jules' article for that. Next slide. And yes, we know the evaluation outcomes we should be looking at. IOM in the standards of care looked at the following efficacy, safety, effectiveness, equity, I believe was added later on, patient-centeredness and timeliness, and also client and patient outcomes, which points to engaging the public, community engagement, engaging the public in the discussions of vaccine safety and acceptance, so that we move that needle to greater acceptance of vaccines and understanding, though, through a better understanding of the science of where the pitfalls may lie and being quite transparent about adverse effects so that the public feels engaged in the discussion and not at the sidelines of the discussion and then distrust of the process. Next slide. I have two last slides to share with you, which I think are important. Understanding and addressing the public's concern in structural bias and racism, and analysis of the greater context of vaccine efforts, which calls for systems response. And VFC and others and the COVID collaborative have come together to say that we're going to weigh in on how to do this in an equitable way with strong support and transparency in the data. And I think that it's going to take a broad-based effort to get us to vaccine acceptance. Next slide. We have to be careful of responding to misinformation. And I hope in 2021, we are now better able to take a look at the headlines that are misleading. And so Johnson & Johnson and the CDC and FDA announcement this morning signaling that there were six cases, one with a death and one with critically ill, related to venous thrombosis and thrombocytopenia, that there's absolute transparency so that you can debunk the myths and move forward in pushing disinformation out and providing the public with good information. Next slide. We know our research needs to better understand vaccine hesitancy, but most are echoing this following message. We may not be able to change the focus on those who are vaccine resistance, but the best effort may be spent on vaccine hesitancy, pro-vaccinators who still have questions and concerns, which they should always have, and then understanding the absolute progress we've made in the 20th and 21st century in reducing infant, child, and adult mortality and morbidity through the use of vaccines. Next slide. Many new levels of collaboration, which you see here, and I don't have time to, but there need to be global strategies that then cascade to the national level and looking at communication, inclusion, analysis of risk, and effective measures such as public deliberation and engaging the public in very meaningful conversations to arrive at my final slide, which is science in the public domain. We must respect the public's ability to understand complex problems, provide the scientific basis for this, have the organizational structure at the city level, the state level, national and global levels to really focus on equity and ethics and distribution, where the science is able to help us to combat pandemics such as COVID. And I'll stop here. Thank you.
Good. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for two outstanding presentations. We've gone from the cell membrane to social equity, which is a pretty big swoop. And I want to see if I can get us into the Q&A. Oh. I cannot. Lauren, are you there?
Hi, Dr. Barondess. I can get started if you hit the Q&A.
Get this thing.
Sure. So I'll pitch one question to our speakers. Could an mRNA...
Let me, before you do that, I want to ask particularly Dr. Knipe about the prospect for long latency with the COVID virus. Is there an analogy to the herpes viruses, or is this COVID likely to to burrow in and reappear in one fashion or another in the future in individuals?
So that's a good question. What is long COVID? What does that do to? Is it due to persistence of the virus or persistence of viral antigens and continued immune stimulation or something? I mean, it could be both of those. I mean, the hint. I mean, I think we need to look more at the individuals who have long COVID who have been vaccinated and what comes out. I mean, there's been some anecdotal information that some of these people may be improved, their medical status may be improved by vaccination, which suggests that there may be some persistent, you know, chronic infection. And I think it may not be a latent infection. It may be more of a chronic, ongoing persistence.
Uh-huh.
The RNA, you know, in general, the RNA viruses don't have a means to go to establish a true latency. I mean, there have been reports that maybe the RNA gets copied into DNA, which then can be integrated. But I think in general, RNA viruses persist by a chronic infection by a low-grade infection at some point in the body. And certainly the hepatitis, you know, A virus and some of the others persist at a very low level in the body. And so it's a persistence, more of a chronic infection rather than a latent infection. But yes, you could have persistence, and whether that may be part of the chronic or the long COVID. I would guess that part of the long COVID is just a prolonged, you know, heightened immune response, sort of like a infectious mononucleosis or chronic fatigue kind of thing. But I would guess that, we really need to do the trial. We need to really get the information about what happens when you vaccinate people with long COVID.
All right, thank you. Lauren, let's open this to the questions of the group.
Sure, so I'll start with a question from Dean Fried. Thanks for joining us, Dean Fried. Would you both suggest improvements we can make in communication around the benefit to cost ratio of vaccines? Again, that was, can you both suggest improvements we can make in communication around the benefit to cost ratio of vaccines?
Well,
Danielle, do you want to go first? Or?
Sure. I mean, I think you're alluding to the fact that perhaps we've forgotten in the 20th century the deaths that occurred and the disability that has occurred, for example, for the polio epidemic, right? And the global scourge of polio and smallpox, which most people do not remember. So the cost-benefit analysis is a tough one. And it's something that we see in public health, which is when you prevent something, it's very hard to show the negative. So I think you're right. We need to resurface our discussions around what used to be. Now, I think, unfortunately, this past year has been quite a brisk reminder of the impact of infectious diseases and pandemics such as COVID, right? We have lost more than 500,000 individuals in this country and worldwide. We have millions of people affected. So if you mean a formal cost-benefit analysis, yeah, I think. But I think communication to the public is communicating at the individual level and to the public of what disability, illness, and loss death means versus investment in primary prevention, which is what vaccines are. So I'm not giving you an economic analysis, but I'm giving you an analysis how we might communicate more effectively to the public.
All right. David, you have a comment?
Yes, and I would say that in our article, we actually started out by saying that vaccines are estimated to save 6 million lives per year. And that's where we started from. I should have started from that point today as well, but we were talking more about safety versus you know, about sort of the scientific basis of that. But I think you're right that that the discussions with the public, and we need to do more talking about the numbers of lives that have been saved by vaccines, and that vaccines are, you know, really are among the best public health tools that we have. And I think we do need to really drive that lesson home as much as we can. And I think Atul Gawande has raised this, and I had actually thought something about it before. And that's that, I grew up in rural Ohio and was familiar with the kind of agricultural extension service coming out of the land grant colleges, where they have agricultural specialists for every county. And they go out, and their role is to help, you know, sort of bring out the latest in agricultural approaches for farmers. And then they have this, what's sometimes called a kind of a surreptitious program, the 4-H program, where they have the kids learning the most recent things. So I really think, I think that there could be a medical extension program, sort of the same thing, where there are, for each county and for each sort of community, there could be representatives from medical and scientific aspects of universities that go out and sort of talk to people in all the locations that Danielle talked about, but in the community and in the schools and whatever, about vaccines and sort of medical and scientific issues. And I think we could do a lot more in terms of education and public outreach.
Outstanding opportunity for the clinical and public health communities to join hands in the interest of tackling the disease burden of the population. All right, we have another question.
Hi, so I have, I'll just say that there are quite a few questions in the Q&A box, so we'll do our best to get to as most of them as possible. Here's a question for Dr. Knipe. What's the difference between DNA type virus vaccines such as herpes and RNA type of virus such as SARS-CoV-1 and SARS-CoV-2?
They're really very, really no difference in some ways, but really what you're trying to do is for each virus might have a slightly different susceptibility point in terms of the immune response, and different immune responses will control different viruses, and they don't just sort of break down as RNA versus DNA as much as just how much, whether the virus goes through the blood and antibodies will control it, or whether it's really cell associated and then you need T cells. So I think it really depends on the biology of the virus and not what the genome is.
Right. All right. Lauren, what's next?
Sure. Can you comment on the role of autoimmune disease in complicating the body's response to vaccines, potentially making vaccines less safe?
Terrific question. David, that sounds like you.
Yes, so that's right. That is a critical issue, that autoimmune diseases sometimes will lower the, in addition to being an over exuberant response, it may be misdirected. And so especially if somebody is somewhat immunosuppressed, then they may not respond. They may not respond as well to a vaccine. So it's a tricky matter of trying to induce immune responses to this foreign antigen while lowering the autoimmune responses at the same time. So it's a tricky thing, and that's something that for people with autoimmune diseases, you know, they need to consult with their physician about what's the best strategy for them.
All right. What else do we have, Mark?
Okay, another question. This is a general question. Are mRNA vaccines going to be revealed to rarely or potentially cause blood clots as well?
I see nobody is.
Well, I mean, I mean,
we can react. Go ahead.
Go ahead, Danielle.
Nobody is leaping to answer that.
Well, we're not leaping because I think the data thus far, and you may have all seen the live streaming of the CDC and FDA statement on Johnson & Johnson, and they were asked a similar question by the press, and they have not been the reported thrombosis and thrombocytopenia that's been reported in Johnson & Johnson and AstraZeneca. But again, post-marketing surveillance, something that Dr. Knight commented on, is going to be important in taking a look as we have greater power to take a look at rare adverse effects. David?
David, what do you think about that? What about establishing causality for these exquisitely uncommon.
That's what event. I was going to say. I mean, so we're only guessing. So I can only guess at this point. Because we don't know the cause. And so until, you know, we can't really hypothesize much until then. I mean, if it's really due to a strong innate inflammatory response to the adeno vaccines, then yes, there might, and it's some unique aspect of that, then sure, the RNA vaccines will also induce an innate response, but it may not be slightly different, or it may be just less potent. And so there may be at a lower level, and that it will be revealed only. But I think it's really important to determine the cause And the critical thing that we'll be waiting for is to see what's the profile of the people that seem to be having the reaction, and can we kind of avoid that group for the adeno vaccines.
Very complex arena. I think we have time for one or two more. Lauren, what have we got?
Sure. I have a question about could the vaccines protect against a coronavirus that doesn't use the spike protein to latch itself onto cells?
Well, the coronaviruses all use the spike protein for entering cells. I mean, they have different. I mean, they have a spike protein that's different, and so the same. So the same antibodies that bind to the COV2 spike protein might not bind to the receptor binding site on COV1 even, but there could be antibodies that bind to other more conserved regions that might cross neutralize between COV1 and COV2. Those have been hard to find so far, but certainly T cell responses. I mean, yeah, T cell responses might cross react to conserved epitopes in the different coronaviruses. But your question is partly getting at how do we get a pan coronavirus vaccine, and that will be for the future as well. We didn't really talk about that, but you know, this was the pan influenza, the universal flu vaccine was going to be the priority of the previous administration's healthcare goals, but the people have been working on that. It's been tough for the universal flu vaccine, and so the universal coronavirus vaccine is even further down the road. But that's certainly a goal for the future. Yes.
But we have time for one more.
Okay. Last question here. So what are the long-term implications for our species if we vaccinate against viruses? Aren't there ripple effects beyond the specific disease we are protecting against?
All right, anybody?
sure, I mean, it's certainly, I mean, it's certainly one big ecosystem, and there might be effects of, I mean, if we were really successful and get rid of one vaccine, one virus, I mean, we've, but, you know, I think that, and especially something like a herpes virus where there's latent in the body, and are there beneficial effects of herpes viruses? I mean, that's really speculation, but we got rid of, we've eliminated wild smallpox from the world. And so, you know, a number of years later, we're still, we haven't seen any negative impacts of that, but it's definitely something where it is part of a larger ecosystem. That's something we have to keep in mind.
Well, I think we're going to have to declare that the witching hour has struck. I think this has been enormously informative and very, very broad ranging. I want to thank our two spectacular speakers for a wonderful, wonderful program. And I thank everyone who has attended and those who sent in questions, and our wonderful Lauren, who runs all the logistics and dynamics. So thanks, everyone. Thank you, David. Thank you, Danielle.
Thank you.
And thanks all for attending. We're adjourned.